Big red. There we go. Good. Okay, so welcome everybody.
Thank you.
Let's go. I got my three surgeries in last month. I guess I'm better. So we're talking about scan tools and what they couldn't do, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, let's first review what we talked about last week to make sure we're all on the same page. I looked at Sears sales for Labor Day and I didn't see anything like really stunning. But what I did discover is if you go to Lowe's.com and you go to Sears.com, you're going to find out that Lowe's is a way more expensive place to buy Craftsman tools.
Not really.
Okay, that's when I'm recording on YouTube, which is kind of stupid. But in my opinion, that's just something I noticed. I'm sure I'm wrong. So let's make sure that we are on the same page. Golly, you're only paying $80 for this? Dang. All right, so there we are, talking about scan tools. OBD2, talking about the cheap ones. And we are talking about the fact that the scan tool is going to give us access to the network. Now, most of the cheaper scan tools are only going to give you access to the PCM, power chain control module. That is to say, the computer that controls and monitors the engine and the engine systems. Now, more expensive scan tools, $20 more, $30 more, $40 more, they're going to give you access to the analog brake system, is the first one usually. Then it goes to things like the airbag system, supplemental restraint system. Then if you go to like heavy duty truck stuff, it'll do like the diesel particulate filter regeneration. Anyway, they keep giving you more and more features until the point where you finally get the expensive scan tool, like the fancy Autels, which will give you access to every computer on the network. And we said that networking is just a fancy term for connecting computers. And these are computers on the vehicle, onboard computers, that are all going to be talking to each other, interacting with each other, and they're all going to be constantly monitoring the system that they control to make sure that they're working correctly. That's great. That's fantastic, because it means we can have pretty sophisticated systems and still have the diagnostic power to run them practically, in a practical sense, which is to say, if we start having problems, we don't have to, you know, completely get out there with a voltometer and try to figure this stuff, take this stuff apart and hit it with a voltometer. We have the computers actually doing a bunch of the testing for us. So we can find out stuff before it becomes a problem. We can find out stuff after it becomes a problem, so we don't tear apart the whole dashboard to find out something is not even in the dashboard. The problem isn't even in the dashboard. So it's really revolutionized auto repair, and it's really revolutionized motor vehicles as far as that goes, in terms of our ability to get really sophisticated systems and to run them with just average everyday Joes. It's similar to what we saw happen in personal computers. I mean, back in the day when I was building computer, I built my first computer in 1987, and we had to write down, you know, all the particulars of a hard drive just to get it to work. Back in the days, we had a 30 megabyte hard drive and couldn't fill it. Windows 3.0, but green screen, orange screen, back in the day. So anyways, my point was, you know, we thought, you know, back in those days, you had to be like a real sharp cat just to get on the internet, the dial up. But what we're finding now is as these get more and more sophisticated, you have to know less and less to get more and more function out of them. For instance, it used to take 4 years of college to make a web page. Now it's really easy. Now, you know, little 8-year-old kids can do it, primarily because things are getting automated that you used to have to know how to do yourself, HTML. So the same thing's going on with cars, and that's fantastic, because what it does is it brings down the skill level necessary to repair and analyze and diagnose and service these vehicles, which is great. It's great for consumers and it's great for the repair industry. So that's what the scan tool does. And we talked about the check engine light, the service engine soon, what the OBD2 calls the malfunction indicator lamp.
Can you get me a water and refresh?
And we talked about the fact that when the computer finds a problem, it's going to sit there and wait to see if it happens again. It's going to set what's called a pending code, and it's going to sit and wait and see if it happens again. If it happens again, then it's going to turn on the malfunction indicator lamp. It's going to store a code, diagnostic trouble code, DTC, and it's also going to take a freeze frame, which is a snapshot of fundamental engine data occurring at the time of the fault. So that gives us some clues as to what the problem might be and how to fix it, whether it's happening at an idle or when it's happening when you go up a hill or anything like that, when the engine's hot or cold or whatever. We talked about the fact that there's two types of malfunction indicator lamps. There's solid ones and there's flashing ones. Solid ones mean the computer has found a problem at least twice, set a diagnostic trouble code, and stored a freeze frame. Flashing one means that you are at risk of imminent catalytic converter or engine damage and you need to pull over. So that's like flooding the engine with gasoline or flooding the catalytic converter with raw fuel. Okay. Now, we talked about when the computer is testing the systems that it controls, that's called monitors. And especially when it comes to buying a new used car, these monitors are a big issue now because we got to make sure that the vehicle has run all the monitors and that it's passed. And we talked about the fact that usually when people are trying to sell you a car that they can't get fixed, they're going to do something to trick you into thinking that the vehicle's okay because it won't have a check engine light only because it hasn't run the monitors. So we talked about the monitors, two types of monitors. There's continuous monitors, there's non-continuous monitors. The continuous monitors are running all the time. Non-continuous monitors only run at certain points. That's usually when they're trying to trick you, like if they got evaporative emission controls problems or exhaust gas recirculation problems, they're hoping you'll pass them the cash before the light comes back on, which it eventually will, usually on the drive home. So we talked about how the cheap scan tools have green, red, and yellow lights to signify that either the monitors have run and found a problem, that's the red one, the monitors have run and haven't found a problem, that's the green one, or the monitors haven't run, or at least haven't completed yet. And we talked about the fact that if you're trying to buy a used car and they've recently erased the code, erased the check engine light, or they've disconnected the PCM fuse, or they've disconnected the battery, you will get the yellow indicator signifying that the monitors haven't run yet, which is a telltale sign that they're trying to fool you. And we talked about the fact that if the check engine light is supposed to be on, but they disconnected the battery or disconnected or something like that, it'll still show up on a scan tool because the scan tool is going to access the computer itself. Okay. All right, we talked about the different key positions. We talked about the fact that when you're running the scan tool, it'll power up without the key even being in it, but it will only give you access to the PCM when the ignition's on, because that's what's going to give you power to the powertrain control module, which is the computer that runs and monitors the engine and engine systems. All right, there's the pending codes. There's the alphanumeric codes. P stands for powertrain, just like if you have a body control module code, like a window motor that won't roll down, that'll give you a B0133 or whatever. All right, we talked about data. We talked about the fact that freeze frame is only going to give you a minimum data set, but that's going to give you some diagnostic insights that'll help you repair the vehicle. Like, for instance, we see that this is at 2800 RPM, which is probably freeway speed, or at least accelerating pretty good. That's pretty high. Of course, if it's 17 miles an hour, it's not going freeway speed. I don't know what you're doing at 2800 RPM at 17 miles an hour. Probably doing a burnout. You know, I had a student who's actually, he's like 17 years old. He owns a 41 Pontiac Silver Street. Beautiful old car. You know, he's part of the lowrider scene. And what's happening now is the lowrider guys are getting kicked out. They can't have their car shows anymore because these jackasses are showing up with their trucks and they're throwing trash all over the place and doing burnouts. And what's happening now is the cities and the police are saying, we don't want you guys around to the lowrider guys. So
sucks.
Yeah, that sucks. That sucks. So there's a lowrider show this weekend in Bellflower and I think Yorba Linda. You can look it up on SoCal Car Culture, I think, yeah, .com or whatever. Anyways, yeah, now they're saying, you know, pick up after yourself. You know, and these lowrider guys, they're spending 40, 60, 100 grand on their cars. You ain't going to be throwing trash and doing burnout. Right. Most of them, I got 100 horsepower anyway. So anyways, my point was, we were talking about scan tools and we started going through the menus, the codes menu, stored codes. That means it's seen something more than once and it has illuminated the malfunction indicator lamp. Penny codes means it's detected a problem once, but it hasn't happened again. It's waiting to see if it happens again. And permanent codes, which is a new class of codes. And what that means is you cannot erase this code until it's fixed. The reason they did that is because they didn't want people to be able to get their cars smogged if perchance the monitor hasn't run yet. Like EVAP codes tend to be like this. If you got a bad seal on the top of your gas tank or something like that, well, the smog laws allow you to test your car if it still hasn't run one monitor. So if you know you got an EVAP problem, what people would do is they'd run every monitor except one, they'd go in and get their car smogged. Well, these permanent codes, you cannot erase them until the code, until the problem has been fixed. So you would actually have to run the vehicle until that monitor ran. It's just another thing that's going to take longer and cost more to get your car fixed, but you can understand the spirit behind it. Mm-hmm. All right. Erasing codes. Gotta be careful about erasing codes. Everybody wants to erase codes as if that erases the problem. Like making burglary legal so that you don't have to worry about putting people in jail.
Is this new stuff to write down?
No, this is last week's, right?
I don't have.
Well, it's not last week?
Yes.
Okay. See? What happens? You got lost in my eyes.
No, I've been writing everything down and I don't see. Oh, here it is. Never mind.
Tell to get old, isn't it? So we started talking about different types of data, and I hope you had a chance to look at that video, electronic engine controls, on my YouTube channel, David Rowcliffe.
I did watch it. I watched all your videos.
Yeah, see how fat I used to be?
What happened? You look great.
Gastric sleeve, man. Saved my life. Changed my life. 100 pounds since Thanksgiving.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. I was like, no.
Yeah.
Wow.
People keep talking about how bad crack is, but it worked great for me. Kidding. Anyway, so we talked about different things that you're likely to see on live data. And what you're going to see is abbreviations. So what I wanted to talk to you about was what the abbreviation stood for. And we'll talk more about the significance of these things later. But I just kind of wanted to get you started on scan tools so that you get fired up about buying a scan tool and you go out and actually buy one, teach yourself right. And it says, yeah, it's different buttons on the cheap scan tool. So we're talking about freeze frame, IM readiness, that's the monitors, DTC lookup. Like I said, I would much rather use the internet than the generic scan tool. and possible causes and fixes, which is a good way to get yourself in trouble. I mean, it's sometimes helpful. It's worth considering, but it's a good way to get yourself in trouble because this is what the guys at the auto repair places use to sell parts. So, I mean, what we need to do is we need to start developing a sense of what we can fix ourselves and what we need to leave to someone else. But even if we do have someone else do it, we're going to be way better off if we go in there and say, you know what, I got a P1612. Something's going on with the throttle position sensor or whatever it is. I just don't have the tools to fix it. Then the mechanic's going to be like, uh-oh, this person's actually done some research. I can't go round and round and say, okay, let's replace all the injectors, right? You know, lest they be tempted to, and, you know, there's a lot of dishonest people in this world, especially, you know, you look at small business owners are getting hammered, you know, even under optimum conditions, they're under a lot of pressure, but you add all this other stuff going on and, you know, it's just going to, you know what we used to say back in the olden days? We used to say, keep the honest people honest, right? The reason you don't leave your bicycle outside on the front lawn is not to deter thieves, because that would be very cynical. What we're trying to do is we're trying to keep the honest people honest, because the simple fact of the matter is, if you make something too tempting, I mean, the best trained dog in the world, if you keep slapping it in the face with a stake, eventually it's going to break. So used to call it keeping the honest people honest. People are under a lot of pressure right now, so we want to help them do the right thing, I guess is the nice way of putting it. So that's what we can do with scan tools. I haven't seen any amazing sales, but, you know, for $65, I don't think you're going to do better than that, no matter what you do. I saw something in Sears that I thought was pretty good. Oh, yeah, I did. So let me show you. right there. Let's get out of here, go over to here. Now, this I never would have believed, but I started looking at Snap-on. Did you know, Chuck, did you know that those Snap-on torque wrenches, this is the exact same torque wrench that I was selling, what, last semester for $100? Did you know that these things are $410? Mm-hmm. New, which means list price, I mean, price for us with our 50% discount is still going to be like $200, maybe $210. And I was selling these all day long for $100. Now I'm filled with regret. Okay, so here's what you need to do, folks. You need to go to snapon.com. Go where it says our customers. Are you watching? Go to our customers. Come down here where it says schools and students. Hit that button. Now. Yeah, stay out of that shop Snap-on catalog. You might have a heart attack. Yeah. Anyway, so it says schools and students. Come here where it says students. And I mean, that might be Chafee College, actually, because they have a aviation mechanics program. So what you want to do is you want to come here to Snap-on program, and you would go to register. That's all it takes. That's all it takes to create a student account. Now they're going to hit me up and they're going to ask me if you're a full-time student, but that's what it takes on the Snap-on. On the Matco, it's even simpler than that. Is that showing you? Yeah, right there. There we go. So you go to Matco Tools, Tech, Matco Tools /tech-ed. And it says Technical Educational Program. Sign in or create account. Go to create account. They'll hit me up, ask me if you're a student. To a certain extent, you're crazy if you don't, because what I saw, what they sent me this week was a toolbox that was 58% off, which means it was like $6,000 and they were selling it for $2,200. Wow. Yeah, and make your money back on taking this class, that's for sure. Anyway, the point I was trying to make was torque wrenches. Yes, Chuck, I still have your torque wrench. Sorry about that. But look, don't get this kind. That's deflecting beam. That's for putting together lawnmowers. Don't waste your time and money on that. Besides, that's way too expensive. They're like $5. Anyways, what I saw, which I thought was amazing, is Craftsman for $60, Craftsman will give you a torque wrench that will do 20 to 150 foot-pounds. And that's enough to do every lug nut on every vehicle up to F-350s, probably F-450s, well, F-350s anyway, one-ton trucks. Now, you'll notice that it doesn't come with a complete case, but it does come with half a case. And the barrel's made of plastic and all that's a problem, but let me show you this.
Hey, I'm Rob North, and this is the Craftsman Clicker-Style Micro-Torque Torque Wrench. On certain items, like your car's tires, the engineers know exactly how tight those lug nuts need to be in order for that unit to operate properly. But with a torque wrench, you can tighten those nuts to a predetermined amount without over-tightening. And
Nice. Come on now. Really?
Tighten and possibly break it. This wrench has an improved internal clicker mechanism for better longevity, repeatability, and accuracy than earlier micro-torque models. The ergonomic grip makes the job easier, too. For setting it at 30 foot-pounds, I just unlock the grip by turning the lock collar in the unlock direction. Just twist the grip until the desired torque is indicated on the micrometer scale. Now just lock the grip by turning the lock collar back in the lock position. Then I tighten the bolt until the wrench clicks, and I know it's tightened precisely where it needs to be. I'm Rob North.
That's nice. It's a really loud click. Because what I was doing today was showing the students a little snap-on, and it was pretty quiet. In fact, that's the big problem many students have is they don't even notice it clicks. Anyway, so let's go like that. So, Rocliffe is going to go ahead and say, this is a best buy. You should get this. Not eligible for free shipping. What the hell? I wonder why not. I wonder if you can package deal it with something else. Anyways, well, maybe you don't get it with free shipping. I don't know. Maybe it's worth a trip to Pasadena or Whittier. But my point was, I'm going to say you should get this. Yes, you should. Because you should not be doing wheel and tire service without having a torque wrench. Because the potential problems that you can cause without a torque wrench are so huge that you shouldn't be doing wheel and tire service without this. I mean, if you leave those nuts too loose, the wheel can come off. And if you make them too tight, or if you make them uneven, you'll get disc brake rotor warpage, which is going to cost a lot to fix. Plus, it's going to make the vehicle very unsafe. Either it's going to cause pedal pulsation when you step on the brake pedal and it goes like this, or it's going to make the whole vehicle shake when you step on the brakes. So I don't think for $60 you could go wrong on this. They can make you happy, and you know how important it is to be happy. That's $60. That's cheap. In fact, I doubt you could get it used at the pawn shop for less than that. Also, they have a 3/8. Now, you probably don't need a 3/8 unless you're doing a bunch of steering systems and stuff like that. But for $60, look, if you're not going to be a professional mechanic, I wouldn't spend $200 on a Snap-on torque wrench. I mean, Snap-on makes the best torque wrenches. Everybody knows that. They're beautiful and everything like that. Boy, I say a bunch of stuff that I might regret later, but it's true. If they work on the space shuttle, they're going to be using Snap-on tools. The point I was trying to make was, though, I don't know if I can justify telling you to spend $200 on a single torque wrench if you don't have a whole bunch of wrenches and a whole bunch of sockets. I think you'd be way better off to get a large variety of sockets, wrenches, and pliers and screwdrivers rather than spending $200 on a torque wrench, unless you're going to do this semi-regularly or regularly. So this is what I would do. All I'm saying, I think the bigger thing I'm trying to say is a torque wrench is a precision measuring instrument. The only virtue it has is its precision. Now, I noticed that certain places that we've talked about earlier, see, now I'm wising up. Certain places we talked about earlier are currently selling a half-inch drive torque wrench, just like this one, for $20. Now, you tell me what kind of precision you're going to get out of a $20 torque wrench.
Not very.
It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. And if you ever get precision, you ain't going to keep it for very long. So, you know, Craftsman was a great American brand. I mean, I'm hoping it still is. I have no evidence that it's not. Let's ask Chuck Reyna. Chuck Reyna knows. Can't hear you. Can't hear you, Chuck.
Okay, it's left.
Yeah, hit the space bar. There you go. Yeah, there you go.
I have all three of them. For the $200 for the Snap-on, I got the half inch, the 3/8, the long one, the short one, and the quarter inch.
Oh, so there you go.
The quarter inch is good for valve covers. The yep. short one is good for water pumps. And of course, the long one is good for lug nuts.
Yep. Yep. Good for you for using them for valve covers, because most people, they just don't. And, you know, they cause half the problems that they end up with.
Yeah, they leak. I mean, they got to be in inch pounds, and you got to be able to, the inch pounds to foot pounds, the inch pounds. You got to be able to know how to do that.
Yeah. Yep. Multiply by 12. So what Chuck's talking about is this is a half inch drive. We are going to talk about tools tonight, so that should be useful. We'll talk about that later. But you'll see that this one has a range. This is the big one. It has a range of 20 to 150 foot-pounds. Foot-pounds is the units we measure torque or twisting force with. Well, you got to remember that every torque wrench is only super accurate in the middle of its range. So if you're trying to measure 25 foot-pounds with this, it's not going to be real accurate. If you're trying to measure 140 foot-pounds with this, it's not going to be very accurate. That's true of every torque wrench, no matter who makes it. It's like a scale. You know, if you have a bathroom scale, it's not going to be very accurate between 5 pounds and 0 pounds. So that has a range of 20 to 150 foot-pounds because it's got a half-inch drive. I'll just kind of introduce this topic right now. Well, 3/8 right there. Oh, that's in inch pounds. I don't want that. Never mind. Go to this one.
Is it a quarter inch?
Yeah, 3/8 drive. I know it's 3/8 drive though. Okay, this one's range is 10 to 75 foot pounds. So if you're doing something that's 35 foot pounds, like for instance, the steering components, you'd be much better off with this. And what Chuck's saying is absolutely correct. You can get 4 Sears torque wrenches for what you'd pay for a discounted Snap-on. Now, will it be as good? Nah, Sears is right between professional quality and consumer quality. And you know what, Sears? If you want to send me some free tools to prove me wrong, address is in the space bar.
They can't afford to at this time.
Yeah. Yeah, seriously, huh? So what Chuck saying is absolutely correct. And I, you know, it's what I told you about screwdrivers as well, right? You can get 3 or 4 full sets of Craftsman screwdrivers for what it's going to cost you to get, you know, 1 or 2 Snap-ons, not sets, screwdrivers. Now, you know, that's probably a $30 Snap-on screwdriver. I don't think you can justify that if you're working from your home. I don't think you can justify it at all. Now, if you want to show off to your friends, ooh la la, I got Snap-on tools. Yeah, sure, but you know, 95% of all the vehicles in America, all the vehicles, that's cars and trucks, and probably planes. 95% of all the vehicles in America that get fixed today probably got fixed with Craftsman tools. Probably 95% of them. Now, like I said, I don't know about Cobalt and I don't know about Husky. If they want to send me some free tools, but I do know about Craftsman. It's not what it once was, but then again, none of us are. Quack. But there's no way you can justify spending $400 on a Snap-on torque wrench if you're just a hobby person. You know, I saw it yesterday. Elon Musk has $110 billion. I mean, you could buy your own aircraft carrier. In fact, you could buy a fleet of aircraft carriers, which would be kind of cool, actually. You could buy some battleships and aircraft carriers and just float around the...
Sure.
Take over some small countries. I'm like, what the hell is this? Come steaming into port with a couple of battleships. Yeah, that's what crosses my mind. You know, it's not, notice I didn't say you could feed the poor. Like, no, you can get a battleship. Anyways, folks, do yourself a favor. Show yourself some respect. Order some stuff from Sears this weekend. And it doesn't have to be $60. You know, you can just order yourself a set of screwdrivers or something like that. Cheer yourself up, a set of Torx, whatever. But now, Sears does sell some stuff that's not Craftsman. But, you know, $31 for 17 pieces, that's less than 50 cents a piece. And what that's going to do is we're going to talk later about different sizes of screwdrivers and different types and whatnot. But, you know, for $32, you could be a player in the screwdriver game. Now, are Craftsman screwdrivers the best screwdrivers? No, of course not. But they're good enough. They're good enough. And a variety is, what do we say? What do we say? Chuck says, a living dog is better than a dead lion. And that's part one. Part two, this is what I came up with. You know, you get enough mangy, flea-ridden, mongrel hyenas, they can take down the mightiest king in the jungle, right? Mm-hmm. If you get enough of them.
Yeah.
So my point was, do yourself a solid. I mean, you could get an 8-piece set for $14. Now, since I'm such a, if Sears wants to send me any kind of gratitude, the address is in the, just do yourself a favor. Start working on, you know, where you want to go. There's an 8-piece set. That's a 17-piece set. It's always good to have right here. Well, see, that's what I thought. Labor Day is sale. They haven't announced any big, oh, it's Labor Day. Come get stuff on sale. But this stuff's pretty cheap already. Now, remember, they sell a bunch of stuff that isn't Craftsman. I cannot guarantee you the quality of it. They've got this premium brand that's got a nicer handle and it's got, I guess, a stronger tip. But I got to tell you, if you have the wrong size screwdriver, that's the number one way to strip a screw. And if you strip a screw, you can turn a great day into a horrible day. In fact, you can junk a mechanism such that you pretty much have to throw it away or do, you know, $90 worth of repairs on it. So, which you're not going to do. So, anyways, what we're going to try to do is we're going to try to, here's what I know. I'm 57 million years old. If I feel like doing the right thing, I need to hurry up and do that right thing while I still feel that way, because that's not a feeling that lasts, you know? So if you feel at some point that you want to go ahead and get a set of wrenches or you want to get a set of screwdrivers, better strike while that iron's hot, because I guarantee you 4 hours later or 24 hours later, you're going to be like, no, I kind of like a cheeseburger instead. Well, for instance, talk about it. I used to go to this restaurant that was right next to Lucille's on Chino Hills Parkway. And it was like $28 a plate. Well, for $28 a plate, you could buy a lot of tools. You could buy a lot of tools, you know. It's very easy to waste money. God knows I'm an expert at it. I think I showed you this set, the one of the ratcheting box ends. It's got metrics. It's got standards. It's 20 pieces for $80. That's $4 a piece. And that makes you a player in the wrench game. It does. Now, it doesn't have big ones, but it's got all the most common ones except for 16 millimeter. Chuck, have you ever used a 16 millimeter?
Yep, all the time.
Really? For what?
Dodges.
Oh, okay.
They have the strangest sizes that you can imagine.
Okay. All right, so $4 a piece, that's cheap for wrenches. Now, of course, they ain't going to give you a 19 and they ain't going to give you a 21, but, you know, this makes you a player in the wrench game pretty quick. but that's metric and standard. You know, I had a bunch of students that used to be mechanics, and yeah, until they got my lessons and then they became unqualified. No, what I meant was that I had students that used to be mechanics and they wouldn't work on anything that wasn't an Asian import, simply because if you work on domestics, you have to have two sets of tools, standard and metric. Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't say, I mean, you want to be a player in the wrench game, $55, and that's a bunch of small wrenches though. But what I wanted to show you on this was, like I said, back in the olden days, Snap-on used to have a patent on flank drive, which was a awesome way of doing things that would never strip out bolts. But what happened was the patent ran out. This pattern right here, the patent ran out. So now everybody does them that way. And as a result, they kind of lost their biggest selling point. Now, it's going to give you an 11, a 12, a 13, 14, 15, and a 16. It's not going to give you a 17 that you're going to use all the time. And it's not going to give you a 10 that you're going to use all the time. You know, that could be a problem. They give you a 22, though. Oh, there's a 17 right there. But are they going to give you a 10? Maybe there's a 10 over here. Is that all metrics? Yeah, this is all metrics. Okay, I take it all back. This is all metrics. You can get all standards. Yeah, it's all metrics.
Would you recommend getting the ratcheting and the non-ratcheting?
No, I don't think. Well, you can ask Chuck on that. Well, okay, now look. See the size of the end on this?
Mm-hmm.
Actually, this is a nice set because it goes all the way from 7 millimeters to 22. But see how small the box end is on this? Mm-hmm. That's a potential advantage because if you get the ratcheting, it is going to have a bigger end to it. So if there's any clearance issues, these could be a problem.
Yeah.
But
I like the cobalt ratcheting.
Do you?
Yeah, they're pretty good. I tried the ratcheting, a few of them from the Duralast from AutoZone. The heads are too big.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's what they do when the steel's not as good. They have to make everything thicker.
Okay.
Well, you know, if you want to know about stuff like this, you might want to talk to Chuck Reyna because I don't really work on cars that much. That's what students are for. That's you.
What do you think about the screwdrivers, the Japanese tips, the JIS?
I haven't used them.
Well, I work on laser printers all the time, and you got to have a really good screwdriver to break those screws loose. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. So, like I said, I don't know about the Home Depot brand. I don't know about the Lowe's brand. I do know Craftsman. So I was just looking at stuff that might be of interest. You know, there's an 8-piece set for $15. I don't think you're going to do too much better than that. Do they have one for standard? I would imagine they probably have the same thing for metric. For $30, you could be in the wrench game. I don't know. Like I said, Craftsman stuff I have tends to be like 30 or 40 years old. But I got to tell you, if you feel like buying some tools, it's a good thing to do. Just don't buy stupid ones. You know, don't buy ridiculous flashy things that, you know, oh, look at this impact gun I have. Well, you don't even have an air compressor, right? I don't know. Have you guys found any impact guns that are cordless that are worth a damn other than Milwaukee and other expensive ones? Yeah, I mean, that's my personal experience. If somebody would like to send me one, I can try it out for you. Yeah, see, now I know how freaking YouTube works. Well, I'm going to change my way of thinking.
I have a Ingersoll Rand. One of the early ones when it first came out, and it's not as strong as the Milwaukee that we have in class.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Come on. All right. So, what I noticed was, let's see. Sorry, stayed where I was. Let's say I got a P0153 2004 Camry. Let's look it up. Well, like I saw before, like I said before, autocodes.com, R4 transmission HQ keeps coming up, and I don't know why. That seems weird. OBD-codes.com keeps coming up. But what I wanted to, what I was expecting, there's even a YouTube video on it right there. What I was expecting is that, you know, there's a lot of forums for Toyota, like Toyota Nation, stuff like that. There's a lot of forums and Toyota Nation right there. ToyotaNation.com. Now, I'm not guaranteeing that all the information on these forums is correct, but often you'll find that these cars have a significant following and people gather together in these forums to share information. So if these vehicles tend to have a common problem, like the battery cables on Fords of the 90s, they tend to show up in forums like this. And you can find out useful stuff, like, for instance, what we'll be talking about tonight, which is lug nut torque. This is what actually I was looking for, 2004 Camry. Now, the Camry is made by Toyota, but I don't have to put Toyota because, after all, Toyota is the only people that make Camry. It's called the lug nut. It's called the wheel nut. Basically, all I want to do is I want to find out how tight to get the nut that holds the wheel onto the hub. So I'm going to go lug nut torque 2004 Camry. And you can do this on your phone. In fact, I strongly suggest it. And you're going to have a whole bunch of things that I would completely avoid. Yeah, that's where I saw the Toyota Nation first. Now, it's got a bunch of other things, and I don't know how good they are. But what I do know is, well, it says Discount Tire, but where we live, Discount Tire is actually called America's Tire. So this is what you want to do. You want to go to americastire.com. Wheel torque. Can you see that ad? Can you see that address right there?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. And it's going to give you a wheel torque chart. And that's not going to tell you the engine torque. That's going to tell you how tight to tighten the wheel nuts or the lug nuts.
80 pounds.
You need to favorite this on your phone, folks, so that you always have it. There you go. You need to favorite this on your phone so that you'll always have it. Because what we need to do, you know, even though we got four lifts now, we still need to get this stuff, you know, banged out. And we can't be improvising in terms of methods. So here's what we want to do. Here's how you use this page. Camry's made by Toyota, so we're going to go to Toyota. And it says Camry right there. It says two-door, four-door, all of them, 1984 to 2018. That's the years. 80 foot-pounds right there. And that's going to tell us what to set our torque wrench to. And we'll be talking about torque wrenches today. Hopefully, I think. Okay, so let's say I have a 2019 Sentra, and I want to know how tight to make the lug nuts. Well, it's made by Nissan, so I'm going to go like that. And I'm going to scroll down here because it's in alphabetical order. I'm going to scroll down here till it says Sentra. Now, you'll notice that it says sedan base XE. It says XEE GXE. It says 95 through 2018. It says 1982 through 2003. It says 1987 through 1994. So you got to be careful and make sure you get the year right. And you'll notice that it does not have 2019. That's just fabulous. But let's go ahead and assume that 85 foot-pounds is probably pretty close. See, 75 for the 87 through 94, 90 through the 82 through 2003. Tends to be pretty accurate. You'll notice that we do have to be careful on things, especially like trucks. Let's go to a 2004 Chevy Silverado. Chevrolet. What say what?
I think it's 140 pounds.
Well, it depends. It depends because, see, this is the C1500. 88 through 95 is 120. 96 through 99 is 140. Then it turns out that the C2500 came in 8-lug and 6-lug patterns. One of them's 120, the other one's 140. So this is the stuff we have to look up. And folks, do us all a favor. When you bring your car in to have it serviced or inspected or whatever, look this stuff up before ahead of time, please, so that we can try to speed up the process so we can get as many cars and as many students served as possible. And you're seeing here also that if you have like aluminum wheels versus steel wheels, it's going to be a different setting. You know, it's got different Camaros. It's got a whole bunch of different Camaros, like six different Camaros. The LS and the LT, now that's interesting. LS and the LT, did you know that they have 140 foot-pounds on the new Camaros? That's, oh, probably because they got so much power, I guess. So, bunch of caprices. Anyway, this is what you need. It's americastire.com. Look up wheel torque. It's going to be called wheel torque or lug nut torque. Anyway, whatever it is, it's the nut that holds the wheel to the hub. And we're going to be talking about tools tonight. So I wanted you to see this. Now, there's probably other places you can get this information, but this one I know and I trust. So do what you want. And it's going to help you. You know, I mean, it's got stuff like Punzo. I used to have a Punzo. That was a joke. It was kind of a Spanish joke, but that's what they used to call me. Anyways, for your De Tomaso and Chuck's Bugatti. Anyway, I wanted to get you to this site while we were here. Other site I'd like you to see is, it's on Zoom. It's called Citrus Auto /MTRK, that stands for medium truck. Now, Citrus College, like I told you, single Endora, top Toyota training center in the country, also Caterpillar and Cummins factory school. They used to have four open houses a year, and we used to go religiously to each one until they started having them on Thursdays, and then we couldn't. But they came back to Wednesdays, but then coronavirus happened. So they made this video. And this video is actually cool because it's much more comprehensive than the visits we used to have. Now, it's cool to walk the facilities. Very cool. But it's also cool because this allowed them to do a bunch of editing and be really comprehensive about the whole program, you know, financial aid and all kinds of stuff, every aspect of all the programs. You know, this is a huge jewel that's right next to us that's well worth considering. If you're considering going the professional mechanic route, I don't see how you could do wrong here. So it's a Zoom and its name is Citrus Auto /MTRK program recruitment video. And the reason I left it on this page is because you can see that if you went to Citrus full time, it would cost you $4,000 for 2 years. That's ridiculously cheap. You know, the taxpayer is paying for probably 90% of the cost of your education. Well, it's just like what we're doing, I guess. But the thing is, that's not even counting financial aid. Many of you, if not most of you, would probably get it free.
I doubt it.
Yeah, a lot of my students get paid $6,000 a year to go to, you know, school, to go to community college. I mean, we got a bunch of great community college we got a bunch of great community colleges in the area and a bunch of great community college programs. For instance, Chaffee College Uphaven teaches aviation repair. You know, you can get your airframe and power plants license. You could work at the freaking airport the rest of your life. And
that's what my year seven plan doing.
What, say what? I didn't hear you. It's two-year program. Go ahead.
I said my young son plans on to Chaffee College for AV program.
Good. Why not? You're right next to the airport. You might as well. You know, you get paid a lot. You know, Chaffee and Mount SAC both have welding programs. All of them have nursing programs, big money programs. Be rich like Michelle. There you go. And you know, There's so many opportunities available. We really need to take advantage of what's available. I mean, they have fire academies, police academies, all that stuff. It's really well worth a look.
I was also considering taking a welding class before I signed up for your class, but I wanted to ask you about it. How beneficial do you think it would be?
Oh, it's awesome. I mean, especially for me, I don't want you to drop the class now, but for the community adult school, they're teaching a class for what, $80? That yeah. When we were teaching it at LA, yeah, when we were teaching it at LA Unified, we used to charge $100 a week.
Oh wow.
Yeah, because it uses materials like crazy. So, yeah, and they got a great teacher over at Chafee. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great program. Great program, great instructor.
Really?
Now, the question is, are you going to show up late? Are you going to leave early? Are you going to sit around and talk? Because if you're going to go in there and hit it hard, I mean, you could be in the Iron Workers Union by next year. If, you know, you take it casually, if you say, well, it's just an $80 class, I'm just going to, you know, show up, you know, every once in a while and, you know, for a couple hours, and then I'll only weld for like 45 minutes before I say, oh, it's too hot to weld today.
You're going to miss half the class.
Yeah, you're going to miss half the class. Yeah, if not more so. You know, because I got to tell you, the truth about teachers is, if we see you're highly motivated, that gets us highly motivated. We're much more eager to help you rather than trying to carry you around everywhere, you know, carry you to the welding booth. You know, we got too many students to deal with.
Are they doing everything online?
What's it, what?
Is the welding at Chafee doing everything online too?
Unfortunately, right now it's online, but they do have virtual programs for welding, which, I mean, Lincoln came out with a pretty hardcore virtual welding program where you pretty much simulate the whole process, but I'm not sure if they have that online. But the thing is, there's a lot. See, people think, oh, welding, you just get out there with a bunch of sticks and turn up the knob until it burns through. But no, if you want to be a real welder, you need to understand metallurgy. You need to understand a whole bunch of stuff like that, where fillet is and, you know, serious stuff. So yeah, unfortunately right now it's online, but there's so much to do. I mean, in terms of safety instruction,
right,
and metallurgy and, you know, the different numbers of welding rods and stuff like that. I mean, there's a tons of stuff that you need to do in the classroom anyways. So I wouldn't let that stop me. In fact, right now is a good time, because like for this class, I usually have twice as many people as I have now. I usually have a waiting list that's probably more than the number of people we got right now, because people are saying, well, you know what? I'm just going to wait until everything gets better. Well, by the time everything gets better, this place is going to be packed. There's going to be a line around the block, right? So now's the time, right? Whatever the crowd's doing, you need to be doing the opposite.
Yep.
So I was like, that's true with all the schools, right? People are just like, I'm going to sit at home because it's not exactly what I want. Well, okay, but there's people that are making progress tonight. You guys are making progress tonight while everyone else is sitting at home saying, gee, I wish it was different. Well, it's not different. Who's to say it'll ever not be different? But like I said, I don't see any way they're going to be able to. I don't know. First of all, I don't know anybody who thinks we're going to still be closed next semester. And number two, I don't know how they're going to keep this up for another 4 months with nobody dying from it. I don't know how they would be able to keep it up for another 4 months.
They will. Watch.
Yeah, watch. Yeah, watch and learn, right? Yeah. So, yeah, that's my fear too. But I'm just saying, you know, we may be back in the shop, you know, you never know. I mean, the way things change, I mean, nothing's making any sense. So we may be back in the shop next week. You never know. So what do we do, right? We don't know when they're coming. So we're going to be constantly watching and preparing, you know, we're going to be prepared. What's the best preparation? No matter what happens, is the best preparation we can do tonight. Yeah. So this video is 77 minutes long. I strongly suggest you watch it at your leisure. Maybe get you fired up. Maybe get you fired up about the opportunities available in this industry, and certainly the opportunities available in your local area. High Performance Institute. I took a couple of classes at the High Performance Institute. It's one of the few community college high performance programs in the whole country. I took it with Professor Brown, fantastic instructor, hardcore, fantastic instructor. I took engine design and I took the dyno testing, two great classes. So there's all these options, right? they've got Cummins and Caterpillar factory schools. I mean, Caterpillar only has two factory schools in California. One of them is in Stockton. Usually students have to go to Stockton and live in Stockton, or you can come down here and take it for what, $2,000 a year? Dumb. Why wouldn't you? I've already had three students get picked up by Caterpillar. That's Cummins right there. But I've had same thing's true with Cummins. I've already had three students of mine get picked up by Caterpillar. They're, you know, certified Caterpillar mechanics when they're what, 19? And that's why they have lives. Whereas most of the people they go to school with, they're still trying to get part-time jobs at Target, you know? That right there is Professor Rubio. He was the top Toyota technician in the country. And then he went and got his bachelor's in mechanical engineering. Now he's the head of the diesel program. Insanely great instructor. Tons of insanely great instructors at Citrus. In fact, I can't think of a bad one. This right here is stationary power generation. We keep going for green energy. God knows there's going to be lots of work in stationary power generation because we keep having blackouts. You know, the hospital, we can't lose power in the middle of a surgery, especially mine. It's a joke. But I didn't think so at the time. So that's scan tools. So good enough?
Yep,
questions,
yep.
Comments, thoughts on that? Well, I figured out a better way to teach this. You know what that is? Ah, no, you don't, because I'm not showing you.
Ah.
You have to guess. Can you guess just by listening to the sound?
Do it again. Oh.
Yeah. That right there.
Yes, wrench.
A combination wrench. Yep. It's called a combination wrench. Goes like this. Now, folks, I noticed today that one of my classes we got like 60 pages of notes in the first 4 weeks. But, well, maybe 30. But whatever the case is, there is no way you're going to remember this if you're not writing it down. So you want to write down everything I write down. You want to draw everything I draw. That right there is called a combination wrench. It's the most common type of wrench in automotive. This right here is a beautiful Matco. Doesn't have to be, but it is. Great wrench. See, that's what good tools sound like. This thing right here is called the open end. And this thing right here is called a box end.
Same.
Now, why do we have combination wrenches? And then I'll just, you know, I'll write 17 right here, 17 right there. Usually that's the same size on both ends. Now, why do I have open end? Why do I have a box end? Because it's a matter of access. You know, the open end is much easier to get access to stuff, but the open end has a problem because the further away you get from this chunky thick part, the weaker it gets. So when you're out here, it's weak. That's the problem with cheap wrenches. That's the big problem with cheap wrenches is if the steel right here isn't strong, and wrenches are going to be made of steel. If the steel right here isn't strong, what's going to happen is this is going to go like that. And if it goes like that on a hex bolt, what it's going to do is it's going to strip. And then you're going to have a big problem. You're going to turn a 5-minute job into a 4 or 5 hour job. That's bad. That's why good wrenches are important. But it's also why you don't want to use the open end unless you have to. Because this problem doesn't happen on this end. See, it's got a perfect circle. So as a result, it's not going to flex as much, which is why this is not going to strip stuff that this end is going to. So the open end has easier access. But this is going to have better grip, which is to say it's going to be stronger. Sorry. Now, when we say it's a 17, What do we really mean? Well, what we're really talking about is we're talking about the world of fasteners. And fasteners is just a fancy way of saying basically nuts and bolts. So I'm going to come in like this. Come down like that. And come like that. That right there is called a bolt. Actually, the correct name is cap screw, but everybody calls it a bolt. In Spanish, we would call that a perno. It's not a tornillo. Lots of people are going to call it a tornillo, but it's not. It's not a screw. It's a bolt. Bolts go with nuts. And this part right here is going to be called the head. And this part right here is going to be called the threads. In Spanish, we would call that roscas. That's going to be cabeza, of course.
Hello.
Okay. Now, just because it seems like the right thing to do, I'm going to come around like this. Go like that. Go like this. Go like that. That's a flat washer. That's used to spread the load. There we go. But what the bolt is threading into is this little rascal right here. Now you'll notice that these have six sides. That's called a hex. And hex is short for
hexagon.
Hexagon, hexagonal, sure. Which means six sides and six flats, right? Mm-hmm. That right there is a nut. In Spanish, we would call that a tuerca, which is interesting because tuerca is torque. So, primary fasteners we're dealing with in the automotive arena is going to be nuts and bolts. And we're going to use nuts and bolts because it's going to give you a more permanent, durable, reliable, safer way of keeping parts together. And, you know, the motor vehicle is an assembly. It's a whole bunch of parts that we need to keep together. So nuts and bolts is the better way to do that. Now, I could probably fit it on this page. That's a screw. That right there is a tornillo. Notice that the screw does not go into a nut. In general, screws don't go into nuts. The screw is held in by tension pushing open the hole that the screw goes into. Problem is, if you take that screw in and out a couple of times, pretty soon the hole's so big that that screw starts wanting to come out on its own, which is why the manufacturers, for the most part, have quit using screws unless they're A, either very special screws, or B, only in very limited, absolutely no stress conditions. Because what happens is we used to use screws a lot for like inner fender covers going into plastic, but the problem is when the screw gets loose, it comes out and goes straight for your tire. So you know that a screw is a tornillo because the tool to manipulate that screw is called a desatorniador, right, a screwdriver? So anyways, What we're talking about is nuts and bolts. And when I'm talking about 17, that's short for 17 millimeter. And what that is this distance from one flat to the one that's directly opposite from it. Now, this is not a 17 millimeter bolt because the bolt is described by the size of this part, but the head is 17. And you can see that almost all the fasteners on a modern motor vehicle are going to be hex heads, six-sided, six-angled. And that's why we have tools in the configuration that we have them. All right, you got that?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Now, as we saw before, you can have this arrangement here, which is called a ratcheting box end. And the reason it's called ratcheting is because it will turn freely in one direction and lock up in the other. I will show you. Excited. It locks up in one direction and it freewheels in the other. That enables you to do stuff really fast like this, or at least I used to be able to. This right here is box end on both sides. Two different sizes. I think one's a 14 and one's a 13. We're going to see this word ratcheting a lot. And what ratchet means is turns freely one direction but locks in the other. That can be very useful. That can be very helpful. And we're going to see lots of ratchets. For instance, ratchet wrenches. So I still don't have a full set of those. That's why I was considering getting the Craftsman ones. But, you know, the more tools I get, the more work I have to do. So I'm kind of ambivalent. There is also another type of wrench that I wanted to discuss with you. It's kind of a specialty wrench, but we use it so much that I wanted to there you go. That's this little rascal right here. Now you'll see that, I don't know, right there. Yeah, there we go. You see that it's basically a box end wrench with a chunk taken out of it. That's called a tubing wrench. And the reason we have a tubing wrench, for instance, like this, is so it'll fit like that. All right. There we go. Hi, Ms. Garcia, how you doing? Let's try this. See this little space right here? If this was a piece of tubing, like on a brake system or something like that, this allows you to go and come down and tighten this nut. Now, if you didn't have that ability, what you'd have to do is you'd have to use an open end wrench, and you know how open end wrenches tend to strip because they tend to be weak. So, hi, welcome. Do us a solid, write down everything that I write down and draw everything I draw, and make it easy. If you ever have any questions, you can always ask next week or something like that. Because what we're trying to do is we're trying to avoid using the open end. Now, sometimes you don't have any choice. Go ahead and use the open end. But I can pretty much say almost always, if you can use something other than the open end, you probably should. Probably. So let me show you the kind of situation that I'm talking about. Here's a piece of tubing. A tubing is a hollow tube that air or maybe oil or water flows through. And I already wrecked this drawing, so now I'm sad. There we go. Try to redeem myself. Good. Glad you made it. Looks like that. All right, so that's tubing. This is a piece of brake line coming into a ABS block or maybe a combination valve block. That's what I need. Sorry. Wish there was a whiteout for my 20s. Nothing better than dropping that on your pants. Okay. This right here is a fitting. Whether it's hydraulic or pneumatic or whatever. This is just a block. Maybe it's aluminum probably. Well, if we didn't have that special kind of wrench, we would have to use an open end wrench. And we know that open end wrenches tend to strip. So we're trying to avoid using open end wrenches because this is only going to make contact at two points. That's what makes it weak. And especially since this type of fittings tend to be very soft, and they're very soft, so they don't leak. So they deform a lot. So they form a good seal and they don't leak. So you got to be very careful about stuff like that. That's why this right here is the correct tool. As you can see, it's going to grab at five different places. And while it's still going to have the tendency to open, it's going to have a lot more contact than just an open end wrench is going to have. So that's why I think I'm going to have to go to the next page. You'll see this one says 11 16ths on one end and 5 8ths on the other. You're going to find that most of these are going to come on different sizes on each end. Let me I can bring it down here. Bring it like this. Yeah, I guess that's right. That'll be good enough. That's called a tubing wrench or flare nut wrench. Uh-oh. Let's try that. Sorry about that. And like I said, it's just a closed end, it's just a box end wrench with a little notch cut out of it. And that's going to make it so you can use it on tubing. Now, I got to tell you, you know, Harbor Freight sells a cheap set of these. I think two cheap sets, one's metric, one's standard. And I think you're better off using a cheap set of flare nut wrenches than you are using a open end wrench on a bunch of this stuff. Like, for instance, bleeder screws in brake systems, are a perfect example of this. You need to get all the help you can get when it comes to these things because they're so easy to strip. So what I did back in the olden days before I had, you know, the Snap-on sets or the Matcos in this case, I went down to Harbor Freight and it's like probably 10 bucks for a set of three. I think you're way better off. In fact, I know you're way better off. And that'll get you at least, because I mean, stuff like, you know, brake system fittings and stuff like that. If you screw up that fitting, you're in bad shape. Because if you screw up that fitting, there's only one type of wrench that's going to help you. That's not even
a screw.
Yeah, it's not even a wrench. This is terrible. Don't do this. Because this just shows that you were being a bad person.
We don't want tree mechanic.
Yeah. So, you know, and, you know, it does get to the point where if you chew it up hard enough, I mean, once you use this, you ain't using wrenches no more for the most part. So it does get to a point where eventually it's ruined and now you got to replace the whole line, or, I mean, God help you if that line goes to the back of the car. All right, folks, it is currently 7:30, which means we got about a 15-minute break. You want to meet back at 7:45? Big smiles on your faces. Go to the bathroom, get something to drink. Yeah?
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Okay, so I'm going to turn off the recording. So it's going to be Michelle's fault if I forget to turn
it back
on.
I'll remind you.
Right. Thanks, kid. All right. I'll see you guys soon. Thanks.
Record.
There we go. All right. So welcome back, everybody. Thanks for being back on time. That's very interesting. Wow. I wonder if Montclair's still open, because I would have thought, you know, there would have been a big old fanfare, you know?
Yeah. No. Yeah. So check, because it's still open.
Good. Okay. Now let's start talking about the wrench that I know everybody knows very well. Looks like that. Almost never is that the right wrench to use. Almost never. Sometimes though, but almost never. Now, everybody's going to call that a crescent wrench, but this one is made by Proto, as you can see here. Everybody's going to call it a crescent wrench, but that's actually a misnomer. The correct name for this tool is Hi, Jer. Welcome. The correct name for that tool is adjustable open and wrench. That's the correct name for it, but nobody calls it that. Everybody calls it a crescent wrench, or worse.
Why is that always the wrong tool?
Because, you know how I told you that open end wrenches tend to open up at the tips?
Mm-hmm.
Well, these things tend to be open all the time, and the problem's 10 times worse, because whatever slop there is in the jaws gets translated into this. So you can probably tell just by looking that the tips are further apart than it is on the inside. Yeah, you can probably see that just by looking. Maybe not. Maybe if I could hold it steady, you could. But this dimension here is bigger than this dimension here, which means it's never going to hold anything square.
Right.
And, you know, Proto is a pretty good brand. So, you know, you can imagine this problem be 10 times worse on a cheaper brand. So, as a result, this is almost always the wrong tool to use. However, people like it because you only need one wrench instead of 95. And it doesn't matter if it's metric or standard. You don't even have to know if it's metric or standard. You can just use this. Problem is, it's almost always the wrong wrench, and it's very, very easy to cause damage on these. With these, I should say. Now, If you can find yourself a proto version of these, they make these for everywhere from 4 inches to 36 inches. When you need one, you need one. Now, for residential plumbing, a lot of times this will be a great tool. Anything where there's not a whole lot of stress, but for almost everything else, it's the wrong tool and it will lead you to disaster.
It's almost only good for plumbing.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Certainly, you know, if you're doing a lot of the same type of work, you should be using the correct tools. Usually when you see someone using this, it's a sign that they don't really know what they're doing. Or they shouldn't be doing it.
Yeah.
So, that's an adjustable open end wrench. That's the correct name. But what people are going to do is they're going to call it a crescent wrench. All right, Ms. Garcia, you here? You having a good time? Good, good. We got a new student, everybody.
Hi.
Hi, Gloria Garcia.
Hello.
Good. Hi, everybody. How are you?
Hello.
Good. Glad you finally made it. Sorry I got the emails back to you so late, but I'm glad you finally got in. Been waiting for some answers from some other students that sitting on the fence, as it were. Plus, I just got out of surgery on Monday. So, and then students on Tuesday, they're like, oh, well, we thought you were going to be in surgery Monday and Tuesday. I said, oh, so you thought I was going to be in surgery for over 24 hours? Freaking students. Anyways, crescent wrench. Now, Crescent is the company that originally invented this tool. That's why they call it a crescent wrench, but it's kind of like Kleenex or Channel Locks.
Band-aid.
It's a brand name that's being used as the tool name when it really isn't. This crescent wrench, for instance, is made by Proto. Like I said, it's almost always the wrong tool. It's a good tool to have. I mean, if you're doing something really, really super basic or super low stress or super simple, I mean, don't do it in front of me, but don't be working on cars with this thing unless it's really, really the correct tool. And every once in a while, it'll be the correct tool, primarily because it's so wide. That gives a lot of, you know, spreading of load, but it's almost never the correct tool. Anyway, that's the adjustable open end wrench. And I think that's about it. It's first wrenches I want to talk about. Yeah. So I got tools all over my floor. Now, listen. That's what good quality tools sound like, right? It's like the difference between real coins and counterfeit ones, or gold coins and, you know, counterfeit ones, you know, the kind that our government puts out today. That's a joke. Yeah, they're like, monitoring YouTube. Uh-oh. FISA warrant status confirmed. The point I was trying to make, though, was that is wrenches. And wrenches are used for wrenchy things, which is to say when we're using hex, you know, sided fasteners, wrenches is what we use. In contrast to pliers, for instance, where we use pliery things. Don't use pliers when you're supposed to be using wrenches. That's terrible. We're going to talk about pliers in a moment, but right now I wanted to talk to you about this little rascal right there. Let me show you that. See, that's got a hex too. And it's also got a square on the back. That thing is called a socket. Now, professionals tend to use sockets more than wrenches. You're going to use a socket if you can because it's going to be faster than a wrench in most circumstances. But there are certain applications that you can only use wrenches on. There's going to be certain applications that you can only use sockets on. So this right here socket says 24. Remember, 24 is the distance between the flats on the head of a bolt. So let me draw this exciting tool. Goes like this. says 24 or whatever, and then it goes like that. Now back here is the part that goes into the socket wrench. And then it's going to go like that, this, that. So Michelle, who knew you were allergic to tear gas? That's, I mean, it's a good thing to know.
I don't know.
It's a good thing to learn before the election.
Yeah.
Biting political satire. That right there is called a socket. And in Spanish, we would call that a dado. I want to thank you.
6 point.
That's a 6 point. Yep. I was thinking about going into the 6 point, 12 point thing, but I don't think, not right now. Maybe later.
That's what it's called in Spanish?
Yeah. There will be no white flag upon my door. Oh, that's Dido. The point I was trying to make was the socket goes with the socket wrench. Like that. And you can see that that's ratcheting too. That's why they also call this a ratchet wrench. But that right there is a socket. It's going to be made of steel. And you're going to see that it's going to have the hex pattern on one end. And it's going to have the square pattern on the other end that's going to fit into the socket wrench. Yeah?
Yep.
Okay. See that? Socket wrench.
Socket wrench.
Okay. Closer view. Now, I wanted to show you something, though. See that little ball bearing right there?
Mm-hmm.
The purpose of that ball bearing is to make it so that the socket doesn't fall off. Kind of adds a little resistance to the socket coming off. It's just there for retention. So let me draw that.
That one doesn't have the quick release on there?
No, it's a Matco. Okay, so you realize that that quick release was invented by a guy that worked at Sears.
And the Sears one has it.
And Sears didn't want to pay him extra for it. But after all, if your job is inventor and you invent something, then they don't pay you extra to invent things. I mean, Sears made millions and millions of dollars off that. That's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't pay you extra for doing your job.
Kind of a jip.
Well, sort of, but, you know, like I said, they don't pay you extra for doing your job. That's your job, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Can't help if you know, rolls their way every once in a while. Mm-hmm. So they're going to call that a socket wrench. I mean, it's, otherwise, why would you pay someone to be an inventor?
I knew someone who invented a screw, and he's like a multi-billionaire from inventing a screw.
Is he looking for a personal mechanic?
I could ask him.
All right, so that's a socket wrench or a ratchet wrench. And what the ratchet means is that it's going to lock up in one direction and it's going to freewheel in the other. So we can either tighten something or loosen something. And you see this lever right here. And what that lever does is it changes the direction of the freewheel and the locking. Well, I guess at this point we should probably discuss. And again, this little ball right here is just to retain the socket so it doesn't fall off. That's the handle. As you can see, this one's got the beautiful soft handle, which is very nice when the working day is done.
You know those big extension bars?
Yes.
What do you use those with?
Breaker bars?
Yeah.
Get a better reach?
Yeah, quick. I know that's what you use them for, but what do you use them with?
Ratchets or impacts.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, whatever you want. All right, well, while we're talking about ratchets, let's go ahead and go to that. You ready?
Yep.
Okay, so this goes like this. goes this way. That goes that way. That would be Titan. And that would be Loosen. Usually, to tighten a bolt or nut, you're going to go clockwise, and they call it clockwise because that's the way the clock goes. And usually, to loosen something, you're going to go counterclockwise. Usually. Now, every once in a while, you'll see something with reverse threads, like on Mopars, late 60s Mopars. Where's Jim Knott? While we're on that topic. So that's where we got this saying.
Righty tighty, lefty loosey.
That's correct. So I just heard that this weekend is going to be 115 degrees in Pomona.
Yeah, nice.
Which thrills me because I'm going to be down in Montclair doing a bunch of manual labor. Just thrilled. Absolutely thrilled. Great. Anyway, so you realize that the weather.com told me that it was going to cool down starting Wednesday or Tuesday. If they can't predict the weather in one location 3 days in advance, why would you think they could predict the climate of the whole world 40 years from now?
Yes.
I'm just a grease monkey. I don't know.
Good kidding.
Yeah, I'm too dumb to understand these highfalutin.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense. That thing right there.
Timbar.
That thing right there is called an extension.
Okay.
That thing is also called an extension. That's a short one. This is like an inch and a half. That's a 6-inch. Always good to have lots of extensions. One of the problems you're going to see with that 230-piece Craftsman set is that it only comes with like one extension for each ratchet. That's not enough. So what I would do is I would go down to your good friends at Harbor Freight. They're Black Impact extensions. I've never been able to break them, and they're cheap.
Pittsburgh.
Nice, yeah, it's nice to, I mean, every once in a while they get something done really right, and that's one of the things they get done really, really right. So, that's an extension. As you can see, it's got the female end there, it's got the male end right here, and it's got that little ball bearing right there to retain the socket so it doesn't just fall off. So, goes like that. That's a little piece right there. And that's going to be an extension. And that can be anywhere from an inch and a half to, you know, 48 inches. They also make extensions that go from half inch drive to 3/8 drive or vice versa. Very, very helpful to have a bunch of extensions. Now, I suppose you can string along, you know, 8 different extensions to get something 48 inches long. Or you can just get 148. The multiple ones are more flexible, but if you do a lot, say for instance, if you take a lot of transmissions out of rear wheel drive cars, you need to have that big long extension. I mean, if you do it all day, that's what you need to have. So extensions got to be made of steel. As I say, they go all different lengths. We've been talking for a long time about half inch drive, quarter inch drive, and 3/8 drive. So I'm getting tired of talking about stuff without showing it to you. That right there is my little cutie. It's a quarter inch drive. This thing right here is a half inch drive. Ah. See the difference?
Mm-hmm.
And then this right there
3/8
is a 3/8 inch drive. See, this is about 75% of the size of that, and that's about 75% of the size of that. That's all 3/8, half inch, quarter inch drive is referring to. It's referring to how big this square is. Now, why do we care? Well, we care because, similar to what we've talked about before, this is much smaller. It fits in a much smaller space. It's much lighter, especially if you have to carry it all day. And as a result, it's going to be good for smaller jobs. 3/8 is kind of like the compromise between half inch and quarter inch. It's not going to be good for doing wheels and lug nuts, but it'll be good for steering and suspension and a whole bunch of stuff. It'll do a lot of the stuff that the quarter inch drive will do, and it'll do a lot of the stuff that the half inch drive will do. But there's some stuff the quarter inch does that this won't be able to do, and some stuff the half inch does that this won't be able to do. For instance, I've seen students try to take off lug nuts with a 3/8 drive, not successfully. Now, a half inch drive is bigger, heavier, stronger. But the problem is, if you're trying to do small work, like for instance, valve covers is a perfect example. You try to do valve covers with a half inch drive, you're going to screw something up, especially if you're using, you know, power tools. So in general, if most of what you're doing is wheel and tire work, you're probably going to want to be a half inch drive. But as you get more and more sophisticated and do more and more different jobs, you're going to find out, for instance, that half inch drive takes up a whole lot of space. I mean, that's half inch drive. It has to be. That's, you know, because it's got to be capable of doing 250 foot pounds of torque. So it's got to be thick and it's got to be big. Problem is, this causes clearance issues when, say, for instance, you're trying to get a radiator in and out of a car or a water pump or something like that.
Now, there's certain heavy stuff over you, time too.
Yeah, and it's heavy over time because if you're doing this all day long, it gets to be heavy and it starts, you know, wearing out your joints. So that's what I'm talking about. I will just go ahead and draw it to serve as a memorial. Now, they also have 3/4 inch drive for heavier trucks. They have 1 inch drive, 1.5 inch, 2 inch drive. Hopefully, the only time you see those, you'll be making money. Yeah, there we go, like that. But these are the three common sizes for working on cars, automobiles, and everything, you know, pickup trucks. And I'll call that drive sizes. And again, all they're talking about is how big is the distance from here to there. That's why I like that 230-piece Craftsman set, because it gets you started on quarter-inch drive, 3/8 drive, and half-inch drive sets. Now, it's going to give you deep sockets in only 3/8, because that's the compromise size. But if you want, we'll talk about deep sockets next. Might be the most direct way to do it. All right, you got that?
Yep.
Okay. Let me know if you need some more time. Well, side view. This is a standard 18 millimeter socket. That's an 18 millimeter. It's not standard width, but it's standard depth socket. This right here is a deep socket. And there's a warning I want to give you about that. If the job does not require a deep socket, do me a favor and don't use a deep socket. Because the strong part of a socket is this part where it's heaviest. The farther away you get from that part, the weaker this socket's going to be. Plus, the chances of tilting it are going to increase, and that's going to increase your probability of stripping and breaking sockets. Deep sockets, you tend to want to have pretty good sockets because they're weak. Now, where do you need to use a deep socket? Well, So, Michelle.
Yeah.
That Dido song, White Flag, yes or no?
It's okay.
Ooh. Not hardcore enough for you?
Huh? No, I mean, I like all kinds of music, so I just didn't, I mean, I wouldn't buy it.
Yeah. Well, shoot, that's what's happening to music these days, right?
Yeah. Well, no, if it's good, I'll buy it for sure.
You mean like Cardi B?
No. Not my style right there.
I was just asking. It's an honest question.
Yeah.
Okay, so only use a deep socket if you got clearance issues. What I see a lot is students using deep sockets because they don't want to walk to the tool room and get the right socket. And that causes a bunch of strip fasteners, and that causes a bunch of broken sockets, neither one of which is cool.
Right.
So when you got clearance issues, like you got a long stud right here and the nut has to go way down it, that's when you want to use the deep socket. And of course, Snap-on being Snap-on, they're going to make a mid-length that's longer than this but shorter than that. And of course, me being me, I'm going to own it. That was a joke, but not really. Okay. All right, here's a great drawing for you. Okay, this goes like that. Yeah, that's not bad. That's called a universal joint. Sometimes called a wobbly. And it is used for when we have access problems. Like that. Cool. Now, folks, if you get past 45 degree angle, that's not going to work. But if you got to come in that way, it'll work. Yeah, sometimes you're forced to, like, for instance, when you're taking transmissions out of rear wheel drive vehicles. You got to have this kind of off-center thing. You can't come at it straight on. But what I see is, you know, I see students trying to do it that way. That's not gonna happen. Yeah. Good. All right. Now, this tool is related, but I wanted to talk to you about it before you went out and bought something foolish. Part comes down like this. There you go. Not the world's best, but not the world's worst. Thank you. that is this. See that?
Stop.
That right there is called breaker bar.
Kitty.
You got to be careful not to waste your money on these.
Why?
Okay, back in the olden days, we didn't know how to make ratchets very strong. So as a result, we had to use breaker bars, because you'll notice this does not have a ratcheting mechanism. All it has is a big old pin, and it's solid steel. We knew how to make those pretty strong. Nowadays, with modern ratchets, it's still not a good idea to overload them that much, but they're much better, and kind of the whole point of breaker bars has, for the most part, disappeared. For instance, if you look at this, that's an 18-inch breaker bar. I don't see any point at all to have an 18-inch breaker bar, especially since I got the 18-inch ratchet. I mean, I don't see any point. If you're going to have a breaker bar, according to me, it should be 36 inches long. You know, because that's what's going to give you the leverage. Now, for some reason, people keep selling tool sets that have like 3/8 drive breaker bars, which doesn't make any sense to me at all. And they have 1/2-inch breaker bars, but they're only 18 inches long. That doesn't make sense to me. Now, if I'm going to get a breaker bar, it's going to be 36 inches long, because the only time you're ever going to use a breaker bar is when you really, really have something stuck on there tight. But you got to be careful. Now, Harbor Freight sells a 36-inch breaker bar. If you want to sell me a free one, send me a free one. Harbor Freight sells a 36-inch breaker bar for about $20. And we've had really good luck with it. Of course, every dimension on it is bigger than it is on this one. This is actually a Snap-on. The only reason I got this is because I could get it cheap. But as you can see, you can see that there's a bigger gap here than there is here. That's a clue of what side they were stepping on. You know, this is already deformed. So you can imagine what happens to the cheaper stuff. And this is probably $100. So you can imagine what happens to the cheaper stuff. So if you're going to use the cheaper breaker bars, by all means, be ready for them to break. But I have had good luck with the recent breaker bars from Harbor Freight, not so much with the earlier ones, but the recent ones, at least we haven't broke them. But sometimes it's good to have, you know, a 36-inch, you know, long lever. It's twice as long as this. And we haven't had problems with them so far. But if I'm going to have a breaker bar, it's going to be 36 inches at least. Because usually what people do with these is they just get a big piece of pipe and they stick it on the end. That's really super unsafe. Thank God it was a Snap-on. Always, if you're using something that long, especially if you're using the cheap one, be prepared for it to let loose. Do not get put in the position where you're going to break your leg or something. But, you know, how rare is that? I mean, the big thing that I have use for this big breaker bar for is loosening the axle nuts on front-wheel drive cars.
That's, you know.
But that's about it. And that's only if they've used a very, very powerful impact to get that thing stuck on there.
Good.
You know, and if you're going to do that, you better have a really good quality socket, because you're more likely to strip that nut with a bad socket, and then you're in big trouble.
Cracking.
And you better have a good quality socket, and your socket game better be on point. Because I got to tell you, folks, if you're trying to keep a socket from stripping a nut, you better be applying a lot of, you better be applying a lot of force this direction, making sure that socket stays on that nut. Because if it just comes off a little bit, now it's only got half as much contact, it'll strip. Or if it gets a little bit tilted, that's the problem with deep sockets, it gets a little bit tilted, it'll strip. So the problem we have with sockets is, if you're in a high stress situation, you got to be making a lot of force go this way to keep this thing in full contact while you spin it. So
The bolt can crack too, can't they?
Yeah, you ever want to let go? Why?
Because
I worked on lighting poles, like parking lot poles, mm-hmm. and we have to screw those down. They have those big old bolts, and
yeah,
I ended up cracking one time.
Yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, which is the big reason why, for instance, if you're doing stuff like that or foundation bolts, stuff like that, mm-hmm. you want to get out of the half inch drive and go to the 3/4 inch drive, besides the extra leverage. Yeah. Yep. Well, that's how you find out about tools is by yep. hurting yourself and breaking them.
Yep.
Yeah. So that right there is called a breaker bar. You know, folks, we are running so short of time. We're already 12 hours through this class. That means a fifth of it's already gone. I'm running so short of time. You know, and students come in and they're like, well, I've been here one semester. Can I get a certificate? It's like, what do you think you know at this point?
Yeah, what have you learned? Yeah. Besides my name.
Yeah, exactly. If that, yeah. So that's a breaker bar. I think that's about what I want to do on that. Oh, no. Got torque wrench, huh? Doggone it. Man. Time, you're killing me, Larry. Let's see. Yeah, torque wrench. Okay, well, torque wrench looks just like a regular socket wrench. But it's insane how much they've gone up in price in just like the last 6 months.
Told you guys.
See? I mean, I would have expected prices to go down, but with all the people going out of work. I'll tell you though, if you're in the trades, you better make sure the last thing you sell is your tools, man, because that's the only thing you have to make money with. That's how, incidentally, if you're in the trades, that's how you can always tell when someone's on drugs or they got a substance abuse problem. Because they sell their tools.
That's true. So true. Yeah.
So in case you're wondering, that's how you can tell. I mean, selling your tools when you're in the trades is like eating the corn you were going to plant next season.
Yeah, it's pretty stupid.
75, 65, 55, 45. And that's going to be 70, 60, 50. Sorry. That's called a torque wrench. And what it does is it precisely and evenly tightens fasteners. Please, folks, please don't use a torque wrench to loosen things. With extraordinarily few exceptions, absolutely the wrong tool. And this type definitely is. This is a click type torque wrench. So, Michelle, you ever heard of that band, Garbage?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they asked Sharon, whatever her name is, the lead singer.
Shirley Manson.
Yeah. They asked her why she named the band Garbage. You know what mm-hmm. she said? She said, because no. Hootie and the Blowfish was taken.
That's a pretty good answer.
Yeah.
I like her.
Oh, yeah. Do you have an opinion? Yeah, that's a jam right there.
Yeah, she's got a few good ones.
Stole the Beatles licks. Okay, so this is a click type Torque Wrench. As you're going to notice, the problem with Snap-on is it's very subtle. Can you hear that?
Mm-hmm.
It's very subtle. I mean, what I liked about that Sears one, it was like bang, bang. Sound like fireworks going off.
The Craftsman sounds off.
Hear that? As I smash my TV. Yeah, it's kind of subtle. Now, after it clicks like that, you stop turning it because it'll keep turning up to the strength of your bolt. Anyway, the click type torque wrench is used to precisely and evenly tighten fasteners. So that means that if I use this on every head bolt's going to be exactly the same tightness. That's big medicine. Or for instance, we know that the NEC now requires us to use torque wrenches on our electrical connections, because what was happening was they were unevenly tightening the electrical connections in the panel boxes, and it was starting fires.
Wow.
So now you're required to have a torque wrench, and it's required to be calibrated too. That was what
20... and marked.
Marked. Yep. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as we increase our understanding of what's going on and we get better at what we're doing, we get more and more specialized tools, and the people that do the work are getting paid more and more, because after all, it's becoming more and more a head thing than just a hands thing. I mean, yeah, good luck doing scan tool diagnostics or electronic engine controls just because you got a strong back. Nah.
Right.
It's not gonna work for you. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to talk about torque. Torque is twisting force. Twerkiendo. So basically this. Torque is twisting force, and that's the most important thing when it comes to motor vehicles, because after all, when we're driving a motor vehicle, we're turning the tires, right? Mm-hmm. Twisting the tires. Now, Dodge just came out with a pickup truck that has 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. That's insane. But what it does is it makes it possible to, you know, pull big trailers up hills. Of course, it's a diesel. Torque is twisting force, and we want to know about twisting force because when we're putting nuts and bolts together, we want to make sure we have enough but not too much. Okay, well, torque is measured in foot-pounds, which is FTLBs, or Newton meters. NM, and that's the metric. Fortunately, for anything you need to know, you're going to get both measurements. The important thing, though, is that when you're using the torque wrench, usually what's going to happen is on this end it's going to be in foot pounds. See that little scale right there?
Mm-hmm.
On this end it's going to be in foot pounds, and usually on the other end it's going to be on Newton meters. You just got to make sure you don't get those mixed up. There's lots of good videos on YouTube about how to use torque wrenches. I used to spend a lot of time teaching people how to do that, and I still do, but I could spend a lot less of it if you guys would try to learn as much as you can off the YouTube videos, so I have more time for other stuff, or maybe pulling it all together or something. Okay, so we already talked about, what is it, America's Tire /, I don't know what it was.
Yeah, that was it.
Wheel torque or something, I don't know. Anyway, if you look this up, you'll find it. And that'll give you the lug nut torque for all the different vehicles on the road, or at least the common ones. Other specifications like that, you're gonna have to get from service information like the Mitchell Protoman we use. Oh, it looks like we're getting Electude back.
Good.
So you can continue your missions. So, like I said, torque is really, really important because fasteners can be destroyed, stretched, stripped, all kinds of stuff, depending on if you have enough or not too much. Wheels can come off if the nuts are too loose. Lug nuts can be stripped if they're too tight. So that's why we're concerned about torque wrenches. Now, like I said, the torque size of the torque wrench and the drive of the torque wrench is going to be proportional to the job you most commonly do with it. You're not going to get one torque wrench that's going to enable you to do everything. And if you get a 3/8 drive torque wrench, it probably won't allow you to do lug nuts. And if you get a 1/2 drive torque wrench, it won't allow you to do valve cover, you know, for instance. So the question is, what kind of job do you usually do? You don't want a 1/2 drive if you're doing, you know, panels, commercial electrical. I mean, that's measured in inch pounds, you know, 1/12 of a foot. So that's true. Chuck brought this up, so I just want to address this. When you're measuring really small stuff, it's measured in inch pounds. 12 inch pounds equals 1 foot-pound. Which means that if you have 240 inch pounds, that's the same as 20 foot pounds. And you can do that conversion, you know, however you want to do it. For most of the people in this class, this will never be an issue, but I did want to bring it up. Yeah? What else do you need to know about torque? As I say, please read how to use torque wrenches watch how to use torque wrenches on YouTube. Because otherwise it takes like an hour to teach, and I don't think that we can justify spending that much time teaching it when you can do that as homework as whatever.
Okay.
Monday's Labor Day, folks. Woo-hoo! Kids are all bummed because they don't go to school on Monday anyway. I get it off. Why not?
Cool.
All right. Well, we're on the topic of torque. Good. Well, we're on the topic of torque. In fact, the kids aren't going to school on Monday, which means they're going to get burned for almost every holiday in the school year. Stupid kids. I'll teach them.
Yeah, because that's always holiday.
Yep. Good. They have too much fun anyway. That right there. That right there is called an impact gun, pistola de impacto. Very, very powerful tool. Very, very torquey tool. Like the Milwaukees we use in the shop are rated at 700 foot-pounds. Now, they may not do 700, but I'll bet you they do 600. You know, that's probably optimum rating, but I'll bet you they do 600. They're more than enough to tear up anything you can probably name. It's called impact gun. As you can see, this one's air operated because this is the part that goes to the air hose, which goes to the compressor. They've been making these for 100 years. Everybody knows Ingersoll Rand is the biggest producer of these. They make better ones, but they don't make a longer tradition. Ingersoll Rand's been making them for decades and decades, probably a century. And the reason they call it an impact gun is because it has a hammer or hammers inside. And what happens is, there we go. Good. Thank you. It's got hammers inside. So what happens was, as the, this part, arbor, as it spins, the hammer gets kicked back like this. Well, as soon as it stops spinning, the hammer comes forward and goes bam, and it turns the arbor a little bit more. That's why if you stay on the trigger, it's going to keep going bam, 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 which is going to keep turning this thing more and more. That's what gives this its awesome and destructive force, potentially destructive force. That's why you can get insane amounts of torque out of this thing. Now, the typical ones have single hammers, but the really powerful ones have twin hammers, which means they can really pound out, you know, way over 500 foot-pounds of torque, which is, you know, more than a diesel motor. And that's also why if you put a metric screw, if you put a metric bolt in a standard hole, it'll cut its own threads all day long. Yes, sir. Or if you cross thread something where the nut's on this way, but the bolt's on that way, it doesn't care. It'll just, that's why we're going to be very, very careful about impact guns, because impact guns can either be your best friend or your worst enemy. We prefer to stay friends. These are weapons of mass destruction, potentially. So this one is used for air with air hose and air compressors, but that's the thing, that's the kind you're going to see most. And you can get these really cheap, you know, go to pawn shops, stuff like that. You can get these really cheap, you know, 50, 60 bucks, whatever. You can, in fact, you can probably get them brand new at Depot for pretty cheap. Place like that, whatever. But most...
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
What do you recommend for a home garage?
For a home garage, I would do this. But it requires you to get an air compressor. The reason I suggest that is because the cordless stuff, unless you get the really good cordless stuff, I don't think you're going to be happy with it. It's not going to be strong enough, and it's not going to be reliable enough, and I don't think you're going to like it. And after five or, well, because batteries die anyway, right?
Right, right.
Whether you use them or not. So 5-10 years from now, your cordless is going to be junk anyway, and they're probably not going to sell batteries for it. So, you know, it's... If you were to get the compressor, you could get all kinds of air tools that would work for it, right? Whereas if you get something battery operated, then you're kind of stuck in that waterproof. Yeah.
Yeah.
We learned this with Craftsman tools, because first they came out with a 9-volt, then they came out with a 12, then they came out with 14.4, then 18 and 24. And it's like, okay, they keep every year, they keep changing the voltage, which is just basically a reason to get you to buy more tools. So... Still did it, but complained. So this has got hammers inside, folks. If you got an air tool, make sure that you every once in a while shoot some oil down that little hole. Keep that rubber diaphragm in here lubricated. Keep the seals lubricated so they don't burn up, because that's what turns them into junk. And really, most of these things are not going to be worth repairing. So that's the impact gun. You know, the Milwaukee version of this is like $300, almost $400. The Snap-on version is probably $600. And we've had good luck with the Milwaukees. That's what we use. The higher end shops are going to use the cordless version, because that way you don't have the compressor going on and off all day long, making a bunch of noise, bothering the neighbors and you. And you don't have to drape air hoses all over the place. You don't have them all over the floor. But that's a more expensive way to go. That's probably why they're going to charge more. Okay, that's the impact gun. This little cutie. I primarily bought this little cutie because I wanted Chuck Reyna to like me. Because it's one of the few air ratchets I've ever seen that's quarter inch drive. So, plus it was cheap. It was at the pawn shop on Indian Hill. So, it's like, oh, okay. And it was cheap because nobody wants quarter-inch drive air ratchets except for me and Chuck. So you know they're good. Let's see. This goes like this. that. Very similar to any other ratchet. Except it's going to have this thing coming down. That's the trigger. Every trigger starts a process. That's what a trigger does. Whether it's a crank trigger or something on a gun. That's going to be called an air ratchet. Or sometimes going to call it an air wrench. And these are very useful. Like I said, if you're doing this stuff a lot, if you're doing this kind of work a lot, you are going to want to do something that's going to reduce your tendency to get reparative stress injuries. And this is a dandy for that. Now, I've tried battery powered versions of this and I've been uniformly dissatisfied with them. I got a certain really expensive red colored version of this and it lasted about 3 hours before it broke. So if they want to send me a new one to prove that they've repaired and overcome this flaw and defect, my address is in the space bar. But yeah, it was like $300 and it broke after like 3 hours.
That blows.
These things are bulletproof because they made them super heavy. It's not like a new design. They've had the same basic design for 50 years. And after all, if it ever goes bad, you throw it in the gutter and go buy another because they're only like $30-$40 anyway.
Who makes that one?
That's Ingersoll Rand.
Okay.
And the red is whoop, Milwaukee?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, did you notice that Harbor Freight now is making their stuff so it's like the exact same color red as Milwaukee? They're like, oh, yeah, compare it. Yeah. Oh, they compare. All right.
They make those also in 3/8 and 1/2 inch?
Yeah, typically they're in 3/8. I don't think I've ever seen one in 1/2 inch.
Okay.
But, I mean, what we're trying to do is we're trying to cut down on the weight. And, you know, the thing is, the problem with these is that you've got an air hose coming out the back, which means you have to drape it across fenders and stuff like that, which is kind of risky. Hilti makes good stuff, Jerry. Hilti makes good stuff. I mean, you go into construction, those guys are paying big dollars. I don't know how those things handle up against, you know, grease and impact and oil, but if they want to send me one, I'll try it out for them. Be a lot better off than a lot of people you're sending free stuff to. I'll see if it's Chuck Reyna approved.
The kids don't break it, then it works.
Yeah, exactly. Kids won't be breaking anything for a while. But by God, the floor will look good. I shouldn't talk like that. But it's funny. All right, so there's a whole bunch of different pneumatic tools, a whole bunch of different sizes and shapes, all that. I've pretty much gone as far as I want to on that, though. So let me make sure I've addressed. Yep. All right, here we go. Now we have this thing right here that goes like this. And it comes back there like this. And around Montclair, they're going to call that a estrella and call it a star, but that's not really what it is. That's a Torx. And it started out when we started wanting to assemble stuff by machine. What came before this was the Phillips head, but when it came to assembling stuff with robots, we came up with the Torx. This right here is called external torx, because the splines are on the outside. External torx, there you go. Now they also make a corresponding socket. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Like that. T15. That's called an internal torx. And you're going to see more and more of this these days. Now, in fact, on modern vehicles, if you don't have a pretty good set of torx, you're pretty much out of the game. Now, these come in screwdriver versions, and they also come in socket versions. If you're doing a lot of this kind of work, you're going to want both types. But if I was to get one, I might be thinking about getting the socket version. Here's what you have to do, though. You have to make sure you got the right size. And the sizes on torx end up being, well, here's the good news. You don't have to get two sets. The sizes on torx is going to be T10, T15, stuff like that, T20, T25, T27. At least there's no metric and standard, right? Now, if you're going to do brake jobs on late model GMs, you're going to want a T45. In fact, if you go down to the consumer grade auto parts store, they're going to sell you a 3-pack of torx, external torx, the big ones, primarily for use on disc brake calipers. T45, as I say, is the one you want to use for General Motors. But so you got to watch out, because a lot of people can't tell the difference between a hex and a torx, and as a result, they just start destroying stuff. Hex being six-sided, six angles. Now, what was happening was people didn't have torx, so they started putting screwdrivers in here. Or like the bathrooms at high schools and middle schools, people would come in here with a screwdriver and they'd just start disassembling the bathrooms. So they come up with a special kind of torx. And the special kind of torx looks just the same, like this. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. But what they do now is they put a post in the middle, steel post. So now you can't just use a screwdriver because the post is in the way. And that right there is called, that right there is called security torx.
They use those a lot if you're trying to open up your Xbox.
Right, for instance. Sure.
It's like tamper-proof, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you get the male bit, it's going to look like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's going to look like that, except it's going to have a big hole, you know? Like that. Good things to have, but you're probably not going to be using it a lot. If you use it a lot, then get the right tools. If not, just go down to Harbor Freight for $4 when they're on sale. You can get a set of security torx and then you'll be fine. You know, I don't try to, I mean, I'm not in the business of selling tools. So if you're not doing a lot of this kind of work, I'm not going to encourage you to buy a bunch of tools that you'll use once or twice in your lifetime. You know, for $3 or $4, you can get a minimal set of this that should be fine. And if it's not fine, then you can go ahead and get, you know, more. But I don't see any reason to go buck wild and get, you know, a full set of snap-ons of these if you're not doing this kind of work. Now, as I said, say, for instance, if you're doing the tail light on a C5 or C6 Corvette, the screwdriver version of these is way better. But if you're not doing all this kind of work all the time, and you just have this, the socket type, it'll work. I mean, if you ever look at the Snap-on tool catalog, you'll see that there's no end to the tools you can buy. You can always buy more tools, but you know, wouldn't you also like to go to In-N-Out once in a while or have shoes that don't have holes in them? I mean, we got a million other things we got to spend money on, right?
Right.
So, Harbor Freight's fine for a bunch of stuff, but if I say what I really am thinking, they won't send me any free tools, but they probably won't send me any free tools anyway. Look, if you want to do a professional job, you get professional grade tools. If you want to do home level work, you get home level tools. You know, if you do a certain kind of work all the time, you get the good stuff. If you don't, then why bother? You know, there's so many things to spend money on. And sure enough, if you start spending way too much money on something, God is going to look down from heaven and he's going to say, here's your punishment. Your water heater just broke. Now, where's all the money you would have saved? You know, that's my theory about that.
Can I say something real quick?
Yeah.
On those Torx 8-point and then you got the Hex 6-point. If you're going to work on any German cars, you better get a set of 12 points.
Oh, yeah, huh?
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, let me talk about Hex because we only got like 6 minutes left. Hex looks like this. It's just a male version of what we've been talking about. And then it goes like that. And you know that probably is Allen keys or hex keys. Boy, that's a really good drawing. I like it. It's very dramatic. Well, it wasn't as good a drawing as I thought, but.
It'll work.
That's Allen key, hex key. Sometimes you'll even hear them called L keys. Problem is those are standard in metric and most people are going to use the wrong one and they're going to strip these fasteners as a result. So do me a solid, go down to Harbor Freight when they're on sale. You can get a set of Torx and metric and standard for I think $7. You can get three actual sets. Please do that because when it's stripped, it's too late. Now, what Chuck's talking about is that on European cars, these hexes don't have six, they have 12, which means you got to buy a whole new set of new tools, right? Thanks, European imports.
Yeah, right.
Sounds like someone's got a fax machine going in the background. There's old modem from, remember the dial-up days, 52K?
That sounds like the dial-up.
Yeah, that's funny.
Those are crickets.
So what Chuck's talking about, okay, here's the easy way to make 12 point. You go like this, you make a 6 point like that, and then you make another 6 point that bisects every line like that. And then you just confirm all the outside lines. Yeah, I thought someone was calling CompuServer. Usenet. There we go. Yeah, 12 point. See, a lot of the new modern manufacturers, especially the European ones, are going to require you to get the 12 point just to make you angry. And I don't think I'm going to be able to talk about 6 point and 12 point sockets, but I already taught you how to draw them, and that's half the battle. Worst 6 point ever. 6 point. Back in the olden days, back when I was your age, they have 12-point sockets. They have 12-point wrenches, too. And the purpose of the 12 point was that you only had to turn the socket or wrench 30 degrees to reposition it. So it was a usefulness thing, ease of use thing. Well, this European thing is different. Probably I shouldn't have introduced this at this point. But, for instance, that right there is 12 point. That right there is 6 point. See? Only has 6 point. This has 12. 6 point is stronger. But you have to turn this, if this wasn't ratcheting, you have to turn this 60 degrees to get to the next position. This one, you only have to turn 30 degrees. That's why a lot of times you'll see stuff comes with 12 point, because it's easier to reposition. Problem is, this is always going to be weaker because there's less meat in contact with the fastener. So 6 point's going to be stronger. 12 point's going to be easier to reposition. There you go. Usually you're not going to have a choice anyway, but once you get stupid, you start buying 6 point and 12 point just because you can, I guess. But this is different from this. This is just a European manufacturer's messing with you, just to torment you. And I got to tell you, if you need 12 point, you better be using that 12 point. Don't try it with a six. Be a strip-o-matic. Wish you hadn't. Go this way. There we go. And this is a 5/8, whatever. That's a 13 millimeter. So that's my theory about that. What else?
Did you learn hammers.
Yeah, in the next 2 minutes?
Sure.
Yeah, like... I was talking about hammers. Well, if you want to know about hammers, just watch The Wall.
Okay.
That was a joke. Waiting for the worms. No, we'll be talking about hammers. Doggone it. You know, if I talk about tools at this level of detail, we're going to spend 3 class meetings talking about tools. I'm going to have to think about this.
Oh.
You know, because we haven't talked about screwdrivers yet.
True.
Or pliers. Doggone it.
This is kind of all know about, though.
Yeah, exactly. Well, did you guys get the auto upkeep?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. 2 weeks ago. All right.
Oh, incidentally, Garcia, that right there is the textbook, except this is the workbook. You want to get the textbook, not the workbook. The workbook's going to be about $30. The textbook, what's the price on these?
How much? I got mine for like $25.
For the textbook?
Yeah.
Fourth edition?
Used.
Oh, used.
Yeah, used.
Mm-hmm. I see no reason not to get the used one. I don't. Yeah. Why not?
Fine.
Probably the person that has it has never opened it anyway.
That's so, what it looks like.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so auto upkeep, 4th edition. If you can't get the 4th edition, get the 3rd edition. It's not that important, but get the 4th edition if you can. And make sure you get the textbook, not the workbook. You can get the workbook, but only get it in addition to the textbook, not instead. And start looking through it, folks. Read that stuff. Watch some YouTube videos. Like I say, if you can discipline yourself to watch 20 minutes worth of YouTube videos a week or a day,
helps.
It'll start to show. Yeah, it'll start to show. And it's not really important which one.
Yeah, I think Curse is really good too. It has every system, every car system on it. It's all free. I love it.
Yep. And I've got my own YouTube channel, David Rowcliffe. So anything I do to help, store up all your questions, problems, and concerns, and free tools you want me to test out. And we'll try it again Thursday, yeah?
Yeah. Right. Thank you.
Right, folks, sure appreciate it. Have a great night. Have a great weekend. Good Happy Labor Day. Woo!
All right. You
too.
All right.
How do you make it stop?
Depends what you're talking about.